I'm going to read out a list of names that will be known to many of you. Gordon Greenidge, Desmond Haynes, Richie Richardson, Carl Hooper, Vivian Richards, Gus Logie, Jeffrey Dujon, Malcolm Marshall, Kirtley Ambrose, Courtney Walsh, and Patrick Patterson.
Well, I'm going to read out a list of names as well. And if they are not known to you, I don't know where you were in the last couple of days. Rohit Sharma, Shubman Gill, Chiteshwar Pujara, Ajinkya Rahane, Rishabh Pant, Mayank Agarwal, Washington Sundar, Shardul Thakur, Navdeep Saini, Mohammad Siraj, and T. Natarajan.
Hi, Rudranil. This has been quite a crazy week for all of us. Everyone knows what we'll be talking about. The names that I read out was the names of the West Indian team, which was the last team to defeat Australia in Brisbane. This was from 1988. And of course, Rudranil was reading out the list of the Indian team that produced that absolutely unexpected and perhaps, I don't think even perhaps, it is the greatest performance by an Indian team in Test cricket. What do you say, Rudranil?
Well, 2001 Eden Gardens is very close to my heart because I was there, right? And but yes, probably is. I mean, you know, we obviously none of us expected a win. We all thought at least, you know, they would fight hard and maybe they would draw. Going into the test, I was absolutely sure that there is no way of coming out of this with a draw, even with a draw. But to then pull out a win, it's just I think it's still kind of unbelievable to me, even though a few days have passed. I'm still, you know, wrapping my head around exactly how that happened. And like you pointed out, 1988, the last time Australia lost at the Gabba. Look at that bowling attack. You had Malcolm Marshall, Courtney Walsh, Kirtley Ambrose, all of them took a whole lot of wickets. That's how they subdued Australia. And here we had a bowling attack, and I was reading out those names, right? Washington Sundar making his debut. Hardly plays even first-class cricket, mostly a T20 cricketer, an IPL product. Shardul Thakur, lots of first-class experience, but playing only in his second test and essentially, for all practical purposes, making his debut because the first test he played, he bowled 10 balls before he was injured and he was out. That was way back in 2018. Navdeep Saini playing only his second test, groin injured while playing the test. Mohammad Siraj playing only his third test and spearheading the bowling attack, which is incredible. And Natarajan also making his debut. And this is the bowling attack that took Australia down at the Gabba. Just, I mean, I want to ask you, beyond the emotionally crazy responses that we are all feeling, what's the, you know, the cricketing reason for a win like this? How did they pull this off? What did you write?
You know, so again, so trying to wrap your head around this, is this India's greatest test performance? So you're saying no, I'm saying yes. Another older generation, Ramchandra Guha on TV said, you know, he thought it was 1971. So all of us are in this entire crazy kind of set of, again, emotions basically. And, you know, we're not being dispassionate observers and you think, no, you have to be dispassionate, but what the hell, you don't have to be. So the cricketing reason behind...
Yeah, this is sport.
Pardon?
I said this is sport. Exactly. Let's not be dispassionate.
Yeah, let's not be dispassionate. Let's not be serious. Yeah. So, yeah. But seriously speaking, I think this showed you all the other stuff that you hear around cricket, all the other stuff you hear around sort of about, you know, and I remember reading the headlines before this test match, Gabatoir. You know, this is it. And it's like Doomsday Incorporated. And I'm not saying this. When the series began, I had predicted Australia 2, India 1 because it was a bit whatever. Anyhow, completely wrong, very happy to be wrong. But before Gabba, before the match started, I said, you know, my feeling was that something had happened, something had shifted in terms of the dynamic between the two teams, in terms of power and in terms of what they're able to do because of that draw that we pulled off in Sydney. So it was like, literally, I thought something had moved. But again, based on nothing, but just gut feel. Cricketing logic wise, if you go about it scientifically, I think what happened is they chose the right people. They used the right resources and they made the right decisions in terms of batting order and tactically on the field. And that tells you that if you are that sensible about the things that you do and in a way dispassionate and objective, who knows what you are capable of achieving with what resources you have. You know, there is no logic Then, of course, you can bring in the whole thing of the IPL and the A tours and everything else that's around this team at the moment. But, you know, to be honest, I really didn't think we were going to chase the whole thing down. Everyone of my generation and a generation above didn't think we were going to chase. And so when the chase was on, when did you think, no, this is going to happen, this is going to be done? When was your sort of gut response, Rudraneel, that,
you know, I mean, it's quite funny because I know that because of all the circumstances around it, because of the fact that India were so severely depleted and going in with like basically an India C team against a full-strength Australia, because of Australia's record at the Gabba and all of these other external circumstances that were playing on my mind, I was obviously very, very tense through the day. But if I am honest, and
who wasn't tense?
I know, exactly. Everybody, right? We were all on the edge of our seats. But I thought that India had a very good chance of chasing this down very early on when I saw Shubman Gill playing his shots. Right, Rohit Sharma fell and Pujara came in, and I was like, okay. And the moment that partnership began to take hold, I looked at the run rate and I looked at with the ease with which they were playing, and obviously Pujara was, you know, just taking all the blows and, you know, blocking Australia's main weapon Cummins at one end, and it never looked to me like India were struggling. And so I was pretty sure that here, this is a team that's going for the chase. And it looked to me as throughout the day that they were going to get it. Especially if you remember the moment Ajinkya Rahane came in and started hitting.
Yes.
It was something he hardly ever does. And he came in and he started hitting. And I was like, yes, okay. So even they know that this is on. And it's a very conscious decision that they have made. So yes, I mean, despite the fact that it went down to the last hour of the last day, and you know, you had Pant coming out with all those the fireworks, I like to call him the agent of chaos now, right? Bringing in all that chaos.
The agent of chaos. Yeah.
Chaos.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So bringing in some of that lovely, wonderful chaos into the ground, but way before that, I thought that the chase was on and that it was really doable.
So, you know, so what you're saying is the chase is on and it's dual. My thing is, yeah, of course the chase is on, but it's not going to happen. You know, it's going to be, so I'm carrying all this baggage of fans from, you know, Usha missed her medal by, you know, it's all that. Usha missed her medal by so much. And then this happened.
Oh my God, lost against cross sports.
Yeah, cross sports. Always, you know, multi-dimensional, multi-sport panic is what happens to one generation. Yeah. 90, everyone remembers the West Indies test match, you know, 96, Barbados, 121 to chase. Okay, you remember Pakistan in Chennai, you know, you remember all those things. So, but obviously, the first time when I said this is, you know, I knew they were chasing, you could tell that they were going for it. And the first time I said this is actually going to happen is when Washington Sundar comes and pulls Cummins like he is some net bowler in Chennai in some ground, in some random triplicate in Premier League or whatever that he's playing. And he says, please, Jaiye, this is it, I'm going to do it. That was when I said, oh, this is going to happen. No matter what, this is going to take place. This is going to happen. And I must point out now, since we are all very emotional and illogical, right behind me, if you can see, this is a picture of the first Indian test team that played against England in 1930.
Is it possible to bring that out to the front?
Yes.
I want to get a better look at it.
If I don't smash my...
Without falling from your chair.
So that's them. I don't know if anyone.
Oh, that's lovely.
That's them. Can you see Nigel?
Yes, that's perfect.
Yeah. So that's them.
Yes.
And you know, you just want to tell all your. I keep this here with me. You just want to tell everyone watching that, look, from here, in so many years ago, almost 90 years ago, we are where we are today, and all these players that are there today came from this kind of emotional. This tumultuous and very long history, that's where they come from. In that way, you have to then pay respects to every generation that has preceded this team that was there. And in a way, this team is reflective of its time, is reflective of the kind of cricket is played, the way it's played, and all these things. So, you know, when you're looking at, I keep thinking of this thing that's, you know, which of these old fashioned cricketers would have been cricketers from the 30s and 40s would have fitted into, say, 2020 cricket. And you think immediately of C.K. Naidu, immediately of Vinu Mankad, immediately of Mushtaq Ali. You know, those are the things that come to mind. But literally within a few days of that happening, we are on to IPL retention and whatever. So it's all very, you know, too much change is taking place at this point in time. But yes, a huge win. What were your sort of general sentiments around it from what your cricketing memories are? Mine are going back to a time when I was not even born, but still.
Before that, I want to point out a very interesting thing I read about this this team that you just showed us, 1932, the first ever test team of India, and the team that played at Brisbane, which is that this particular set of people from 1932, by the time they were playing their third test, which was a year later in 1933, the bowling attack had more experience combined in playing tests than the bowling attack that India put out in Brisbane. Because that team had players, by the time they were playing the third test, a combined total of five tests of experience, worth of experience between the bowling attack.
This team
had a combined experience of about four tests. So
that just shows you. It's just mind-boggling, you know, to think what they're able to do. But obviously, they came into this sort of scenario with a kind of a confidence that they got either from the dressing room or from who they were and how they had come into this place to say, okay, let's give this our best. Let's see what happens. And in a way, you did see that. I don't know how much of the Australian sort of short bowling that they were doing across this test series, even to tail enders, you know. So I started getting very annoyed about that because Cummins, basically Shami was backing off in the first test match and Cummins, so it's like Cummins went after him and broke his hand, you know, and you're saying, listen, right, it's not done. So I don't think that helped Australia as much as they thought it would. You know, the whole thing is, okay, we can bully boy you out of this kind of contest. They couldn't bully boy Cheteshwar Pujara out of it, you know. So what was it? It's not going to happen with anyone else. I don't know what you thought about that sort of line of bowling. And
No, I thought one is that I think you're right that Australia were looking to bully and intimidate a little, which is something that that has worked very well for them in the past. Right, they've always had an intimidating presence on the field, and they've always looked to make that very, very clear for the opponents, just like you would do in a boxing match, let's say. But I think that this does not work very well in Australia's favor anymore, simply because India is not the kind of team that gets bullied at all, right? They clearly have no fear about anything. So, you know, all those old fears of fast tracks and short balls and not being able to play the bouncer, not being able to pull or hook and things like that. These are, even if you're not able to pull or hook, the Indian team right now, they will still do it and not feel two ways about it, you know. Like you see Rishabh Pant doing it sometimes. I mean, he falls over. He has no balance when he pulls the ball. But it doesn't stop him and he has no fear of doing it either. So that's one. And the second thing is, I think tactically that really misfired, because on the final day of the test with a team chasing a target, there are a lot of things a bowling attack unit can do to kind of, even defensively, to kind of deny the other team from getting into the target just by bowling outside the line, you know, things like that. And
Making it difficult to just score the runs.
Exactly. And I didn't see Australia do that at all, which was some kind of, like, you know, the way Steve Smith has spoken before, a brain freeze, you know, and it was some kind of a brain freeze, I think, in terms of not being able to stop that flow of runs. And also talking about this confidence and fearlessness, I think that, you know, there was something that was that Jasprit Bumrah had told me a long time back, is that when he made his debut, he was quite surprised that MS Dhoni was captain then, and this was in Australia. And he thought that he's going to get a big pep talk about the tactics that he should be following, what he should be doing and not doing, and the game plan for each batsman. And he told me that I was really surprised because none of that happened. And the next thing I know, Dhoni gives me the ball and I tell him, what am I supposed to do? And Dhoni tells him, just do what you have always done while playing cricket. Think of this as a first-class game and just do what you did there. Don't think of this as anything different. And he said that, you know, it took me some time to absorb that lesson, but that it is something that I do consciously when I go out to play. I think of the fact that I'm going to do exactly what I do all the time. I'm not going to change because of the opponent in front of me. I think Siraj also spoke about Ajinkya Rahane telling him this. So it sounds very pithy in some ways, in a kind of a cliche, just do what you have always done or just do what you did in first class cricket. But clearly there is something there that, as somebody who's not an elite cricketer, I don't fully understand and comprehend, but there's something very powerful there, a powerful lesson in that message.
It's a very simple thing that they always tell you, but the point is for the pressure and for the expectation to be dissipated from that. That's the thing that's the difficult thing. So they'll always tell you, play the ball, not the bowler. You know, play the
right.
Sense that. Similarly with bowlers, you know, bowl to the batsman, the stumps, whoever, not the superstar that you're playing against. It's a bat and a ball, and it's the same kind of a contest. But it's very hard to. You would think to internalize it, but obviously having these guys have played so much of IPL cricket, A cricket, where they're constantly under this huge scrutiny of having to, you know, defend totals, take wickets, whatever it is, that you would think would vanish. But in a series like this, so there's a very interesting a piece about Pujara's choice of that of taking the ball on his body today that I read about. Where he said, listen, there was a crack on the wicket just short of length which Cummins kept hitting. And I knew that if I didn't get my gloves out of the way, I'd most probably be able to, you know, I'll glove it or it'll go up as a catch. So let me just take it on the body. So that was his sort of response to the crisis that was there at the time. He said he knew that let me not take a chance. This is Brisbane. This is important. Let me take whatever I have to take. How many ever pieces I'll be sent back, I'll go. Which is just, you know, mind-boggling to watch him. Take a pummeling like that. And it's happened in the past, you know, and that's what they also said about Steve Waugh, how he played the West Indian bowling. That's what he used to do. He used to just take it. You know, he used to just absorb blows on the body and say, let me keep my gloves out of the way. Let me keep my bat out of the way. And the other very interesting point about this whole tactic is that when India were all out for 36 for 9, which seems like in another previous decade, I don't think they bowled a single short ball in that innings. They just got them bowling in a with absolute discipline, with absolute, you know, focus on where they were going to pitch the ball. And every time they got a nick, when you would have in about 9 out of 10 other occasions, they won't be able to. So they did, that tactic had worked for them beautifully. But it's like you said, brain fade. Or as my theory is that something happened to them after Sydney and said, you know, these guys, they have some mysterious sort of powers in them that they're just calling it up, you know.
Yes, what you said in your column, the myth of regeneration, and how that always has a kind of fear attached to it.
Correct.
Right. But you made a very interesting point, and maybe you can elaborate on that. And that is this the fact that a lot of these debutants, a lot of the fresh faces, they have been exposed to a lot of overseas cricket through the A tours. IPL, of course, exposes them to playing with all the great cricketers from around the world. But also under 19 cricket and A tours that I believe that Rahul Dravid kind of engineered this new program where he constantly gives exposure to any player he thinks who's got it in him by sending them out with the A team or as net bowlers to overseas tours with India, which is what Natarajan and Washington Sundar originally went as net bowlers. Just so that they can get used to the conditions, they can get used to being in the big league with the senior team, the dressing room, and all those things. And can you?
It's the A tour. This is quite interesting because it's always been there, but it's not been consistent and it's not been followed in a way that has you know, that seems to have a kind of a method at this point, like it does. So for example, I think Siraj was playing on the India A tour just before the series started. There was already an India team that was taking part in all of this. And you get to see, as players, you get to see the kind of bench strength that the Australians have as well. And I think we have to see that this whole, there's no novelty left in touring overseas. You know, there is nothing unexpected that comes up. The only question is that there will be a different set of players that you're sort of playing against, and that would be a huge factor. All these players that are there, they've been in the mix of playing some kind of international competition, whether it's South Africa, West Indies, England. just going out and playing players of their experience and, you know, that level, playing at that level, which I suppose makes it simpler for them. The real X factor in this situation was the composure, to me, other than the chaos of Rishabh Pant, was Shubman Gill's composure in every innings that he played. We forget about him because he bats at the top of the order and he reached, you know, 326 or whatever at the end of it, and Pant was just going crazy. But you forget the composure with which, like you said, he started the innings off. And he has never looked out of place at all, you know. And he's always been spoken in the sense, so that would be one of the big, between the two openers, him and Rohit Sharma. Of course, Rohit has that latent fear that he can just do something and then turn everything upside down. The big innings in Test cricket, that hasn't happened yet. But Shubman Gill, you're thinking that, you know, this guy's made 290s in his first four innings. You know, what more? And I think 290s and a 50, if I'm not wrong. I could be wrong. I know 350s for sure, and it was 91 yesterday.
Yes.
So you're thinking that there is bench strength of a quality that other countries would envy. So I don't know whether this is wishful thinking or just some dream, that this is the possible, the precursor of a generation of dominance that you would want the Indians to show, to belong to those really dominant teams of the past, you know, to that lineup from Brisbane that we just read out. So that's the kind of dominance you want to have, you want to own, because you have everything. It'll be really ridiculous for you not to be like that anymore.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously, we've already dominated Test cricket for a few years now, being the number one Test side for a few years as well. But you're right. I mean, just considering the disproportionate amount of attention and that is bestowed on cricket in our country, you know, you would expect them, for example, what you would expect of Brazil in football. Right? I mean, football is everything in Brazil, so which is why they are so good, and they're and they have been so dominant in the past, and they're always a force to reckon with. And this is what should happen with India as well. And Shubman Gill was my absolute favorite, thing that happened in the Australia tour. Just watching him play, like you said, the composure, the skill level, the economy of movement with which he plays his shots, you know, the short selection that he has. He looks nothing like a debutant. He looks like he's been playing for years at that level and is one of the, you know, big openers in world cricket. And I think that he has a very long career with a lot of records that he's going to break. He looks very ominous to me as an opening batsman, which brings me to another question, which is, for no fault of anybody's, this Brisbane 11 that affected this miraculous win, we are probably never going to see them play again as an 11 in a Test match, right? Just because of the circumstances that brought them together. With that in mind, who are the people that you think are now completely undroppable from the team? And who are going to miss out, unfortunately?
Already, Natarajan's out of the England sort of selection, as we saw that happened first time. Yes. Undroppable is definitely Gill. Pant is obviously stating an... And then you're thinking, who else are you going to drop? You know, why will you... And you'll always have a choice. Even amongst your openers, you're going to have a choice. In India, everyone will line up to open. We've forgotten Hanuma Vihari, who was the... One half of the partnership that saved India and Sydney. I don't think anyone's undroppable. They could be interchangeable. Let's be a bit loose with that. I mean, even with Natarajan, you would want a player of his abilities, because remember, he's a left arm fast bowler, which is a quality that everyone looks for. You want him to develop a little bit more experience. If you can bowl Yorkers at will in 2020 cricket, you can do that, I assume, in a Test match if you're trained enough to do it. So why not? I'm trying to think of our last great left-hand bowler, and I'm just, my brain has just gone into a fade again, because I'm thinking Shami. Yeah. So
Zahir Khan.
Zahir Khan, Nehra, you know, that kind of RP. Wasn't RP also?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, no. RP wasn't. Yeah.
No. Yeah. Yeah.
But, yeah.
Yeah. Good.
So you're thinking that someone like that, you should not take someone like that and say, listen, this is something that we can work with. You know, this is something that is there for us to work with. Imagine a Bumrah and a Natarajan opening the bowling together, maybe 2 years down the line, in a test match in England. You know, who knows? So they are changeable, but I don't think they're sort of droppable in that sense. And what's going to happen when England comes? Okay, and another point we must remember: at the start of this year, of the start of 2020, we lost a series to New Zealand 2-0. On wickets that were where the ball was moving sideways, that is not Australia. So that's going to be our next sort of hurdle that we have to cross, which we are going to England in the summer. So I assume we'll see what sorts itself out there. And so there is work to be done in many ways. There are sort of tests to pass. There is improvement to be made. We can see who'll make the progress, but you would think that I don't think the fans should expect anything less than absolute domination. You know, this great team that has been talked about, Ravi Shastri says this is the greatest team ever and all that. Yeah, we're on our way. The team that played in the Brisbane Test match has produced India's greatest ever Test match performance, Test series performance, this whole mix of players. But for a period of domination to be the greatest team ever, a little bit more. I know it's sounding like a real grumbler, but okay. And the other very interesting point of the absence of Kohli, I think one thing it did strike me that had, you know, Kohli's innings in 2014 chasing in Adelaide, which we didn't make it, but he just went, he and Saha and everybody just went for it. I think at that point also, every other younger generation player will say, yeah, it's doable. It was doable. If we hadn't lost wickets, we would have won in 2014. So it's taken us 5-6 years to kind of cross that make that passage across. So who knows what the next, say, 5-10 years are going to look like.
Right. And another interesting thing for me would be the great bowling attack that we already had now has such a great backup. So, I mean, it would be so hard to pick between Shami, Ishant Sharma, Jasprit, and obviously Bumrah will automatically walk in. And then you have to figure out, I mean, do we play Siraj or do we play Shami? Do we play Siraj or do we play Ishant? And I think it's a fair question. I think Mohammad Siraj was, apart from Shubman Gill, my other, great moments of joy was from Siraj's bowling. And he was so good. I mean, he was so disciplined with his line and he was always making the batsman play, always looking for a wicket, which is exactly what Australia did not do. And it was great to see that from somebody just playing in his third test. It was an incredible bowling performance from him. And
incredible energy.
And I think that he should be walking into the team.
Yeah, just incredible energy and an incredible sort of, just sort of a sense of occasion as, okay, I'm here, this is what I have to do, kind of a performance. Now, you'll remember that in India, you'll automatically play two spinners. So then you've got to make those changes as well. It'll also help you to have all these bowlers available to look after them in terms of injury issues, you know, to look after them in terms of workload. It'll be much simpler because you've got this. They've shown you what the rest of the options that are available to you. And you would want the selectors to really be smart about this. You would want these choices to be made well, because what this series has shown you that if you make smart, objective decisions, cricketing decisions, based on cricket and not on emotion and notion and whatever, you can achieve huge things without any of the kind of marketing spiel around any that's needed. You know, whether it was haven't spoken about Rahane, whose captaincy was just
incredible.
Yeah. It's literally like the stuff of legend. You're thinking that, you know, could any other captain have done what Rahane did? Any other Indian captain? I mean, it's not fair to sort of say that no, everyone else is incapable, but it was like literally he was the right man for that job. You know,
yeah, quiet confidence, giving confidence to everyone clearly, to do what they do best, and brilliant strategies right through. Every decision was brilliant. So yeah, I think we've covered everything, and we should now wrap it up and spend some time gloating over this win again on a very nice day in Delhi. I don't know how it is in Bangalore for you.
Beautiful and sunny and a day to gloat and a day to celebrate. And before we go, I think we should also remember that the kind of outpouring of joy that came at the, after that result. I just was on a conversation with Michael Jay, a friend of mine, former first-class cricketer based in Australia, who said the same thing. He said, you know, this ragtag army, he said, I haven't seen any visiting team being taken, you know, being embraced so warmly by the Australians since West Indians of the 80s and so on, which is a big thing, you know, which is a very big thing. And I think it's a great day and great stories and hopefully great success and good stuff lies ahead. So thanks very much, Rudra. It was great fun chatting. We could have gone on easily for another hour if we were given a chance.
Absolutely.
And congratulations to everybody. ठीक है.
Thank you.
Done. Oh, sorry.
Done.
ठीक है. Okay. So
stop recording.
I can stop recording.